Hello, everybody. Hello, Angular Connect. Hey, they did the warm up for me. I want to start a session about graphics. We are going to talk about SVG, Scalable Vector Graphics. But this is the time that you need to say, yeah, graphics, woo! But unfortunately, this is how I draw a man. And this is how I draw a bus. And this is how I draw the toilets. Oh no, I wish. More appropriate. And somebody thinks that I can talk about graphics. This is my Angular Connect webpage. Uh-oh, he's going to talk about graphics. No, let's get serious, okay? So if you don't know me, I'm Gil Fink. I'm the CEO of Sparksys, a small consulting company. I'm a Microsoft MVP in the last 7 years. I wrote a book called Pro Single Page Application Development. I co-organized ngConf Israel with Uri, which is sitting in the crowd here, and I'm a co-organizer of a GDG chapter in Israel. What's the agenda? So in the next 25 minutes, I'm going to talk about SVG in a nutshell. So if you don't know SVG, we'll just jump into it. Then I'll talk about how SVG and Angular work together, and they can work together. And then the majority of the talk would be about a use case. I wrote an application for a biology company that gives you a viewer for genes. So this is the main theme here. So what SVG, you probably ask yourself, and it's a graphical model. If you use the, if you are a web developer, so you know probably Canvas, WebGL, and SVG are the three graphical models that you can create graphics inside of your web pages. You can create 2D graphics using SVG, and it is hosted in your HTML, meaning that it's DOM accessible, and you can do a lot of things, a lot of stuff. For example, create shapes, create things like transformation, transitions, and etc. using that. And the main thing about SVG is because it's a vector graphics model, it scales. It works fine in all the screen resolutions. It will work the same. Here's an example for something that was created in SVG. You just need to put a surface of SVG on a web page, and then you just put elements of SVG inside of this surface. Here you can see that I'm putting two rectangles, and the SVG will layer them if they're in the same coordinates. That means that if you have overlapping, then the last element will be on top of the first element. That's relevant to our biology use case later on. So with that, let's see some cool stuff that people created using SVG. For example, I like games, so go to Blobular and then just do some stuff with blobs, okay? So let's cut it, let's move it like this, and let's change the color here to very, very ugly green. And let's take the shapes for here, let's make it bigger, and etc. So this is a game created by SVG, with SVG. And we have another example of a jigsaw. Let's just play a game here. So who sees where it fits? Something like this. Okay. And et cetera, et cetera. So these are two examples of what you can do with SVG. And later on, we'll see other example of things that you can do with SVG. So let's go on. So after we know that we have a graphical model that can help us create some fancy graphics, let's talk about how Angular and SVG work together. So combining SVG and Angular is very easy. I said, SVG is just DOM. So what do you need to do? Create directives or templates, expressions, and etc. Yes? It's not such an easy thing because there are caveats. The first thing, if you are creating directives, you will have to say that the template namespace is SVG, because SVG has a different XML namespace, okay? So you have to mention that for directives. But another thing that you should think about is what to do with attributes. SVG attributes don't understand expressions in Angular or Angular expressions. So whoever used the ng-attr- the name of the attribute, raise your hand, please. Okay, not a lot of you. Now you can know, the people who didn't use it, that you can use that notation or that prefix in order to present attributes which would be calculated by Angular to your screen. So let's take a look at some simple example of how we can use that. So in the example that I'm going to show you, we have a directive here. That directive will generate a rectangle. Okay, so in the directive, I needed to put the template namespace equals SVG, and I have a URL here that asks for a rect template, and it's a very simple directive. Let's take a look at the rect templates. In the rect template here, what you can see is that I have ng-attr-x, y, height, and width. Okay, that helps me to create the rectangle directive that I created. And if I run that in the browser, the full example here is using Angular in order to change some rectangle in the browser. Okay, so that's simple, but let's start and talk about a real use case for creating things with Angular and with SVG. So a disclaimer, I'm not a biologist. I'm a developer like you. 3 months ago, I started to work with a company that does biology things. And don't ask me anything about biology, because I will just say, oh my God, what are you talking about? Okay, so biology, I failed biology in high school, okay? Sorry. But we need to know 2 things. The first one is, what is plasmids? And plasmids are small DNA molecules that have annotation that looks like a circle. Think about this thing as a flu molecule, okay? It's a virus, it's a flu. We understand viruses, yes, in computer science. So this is a virus representation. The second thing that you need to know is, what is a sequence? So a sequence is just a list of DNA characters, ATGC, and their permutations. And this list can be very, very long, and you can think about it as the code that writes your own existing. Okay, so if I'm standing here, I'm probably having some 1 million, or sorry, 1 billion characters that creates me. And let's talk about what the company that I worked for asked me to do. So they asked me to create synchronized plasmid and sequences in a viewer. And they asked me for fast scrolling, of course, because I need to scroll the sequences very, very fast. And to make selections in my sequence and my plasmid, and to create layers of annotation. Oh, snap. A lot of demands, okay? And I'm a lazy developer. So the first thing that I do, the first thing that I did was I searched for libraries, okay? I did ping to Google, Bing, whatever, and I didn't find a lot of libraries that could help me with that, okay? And I even had a restriction, because I wanted a library that works with AngularJS. Very, very hard thing to see, to search for. And yes, I did found a library called Angular Plasmid that can help you by creating directives to create something that can do something like this, okay, on screen. So thank you, I don't remember your name, the writer of the library, you saved me a lot of time. All I needed to do was to adapt this library and do stuff, but I had a lot of problems. The first problem was they created directives, but I needed to load some fancy biology formatted files to parse them, and after that, to generate the whole thing by myself, dynamically. So I used the $compile service in Angular, so that helped me a lot. The second thing was how to create selection in the plasmid. How do I select some section in the plasmid itself? They didn't give me that option, so I had to improvise. And I created that thing, scratching my head a lot and doing a lot of mathematical calculations in order to create that implementation. And as I said, I'm a lazy developer, and I didn't find any DNA sequence library. So I started thinking about how to do it. The naive way? OK, the naive way was to take ng-repeat, SVG, and Angular, and the browser scrolling, and just try to put it everything inside of it. But the problem is, of course, you need to tell me what is the problem. What? Performance. Yes, a sequence can have so many characters, OK? When I'm talking about a simple virus, it can be something like 50,000 characters and even more. So we understand the problem. And with great data source comes great performance tuning, as you all know. And I had to do some improvisation to create that stuff, because this is a customer, and they say to me something like, you promised to deliver us this thing. And it must have a very, very, very fast scrolling and performance. So I did a lot of research about it. And can we do better? Can I use infinite scrolling for that? So the answer is no, because infinite scroll figure or add a lot of content to the web page. And as you can probably think about, once you create 50,000 characters wrapped in SVG, you have 50,000 SVG elements on your web page. And while you can create scrolling using infinite scroll, it won't perform. And better than that, one of the demands was that I need to go to different characters. Okay, so I need to create a go-to implementation inside of what I did. And not good enough for me, infinite scroll. So of course, you heard about virtual scrolling. And if you didn't hear about, there are two good references down that you can use today. I took those references. I understood the problem. And in virtual scrolling, what I'm doing is I'm just creating a few elements in the top, a few elements in the bottom. And once somebody is scrolling, I'm removing the elements from the top, and I'm adding elements to the bottom, or the vice versa. So virtual scrolling is just how you can improvise and do this stuff. So a disclaimer again, this product that you are going to see is going to be shipped in 1 month. I can guarantee that there are a lot of bugs, OK? And let's take a look at what we have here. So here we are in the genome compiler viewer. And in that viewer, you can see that I have very, very fast scrolling. OK? It bricked a little bit. I'll have to refresh it because of the resolution. OK? I have annotation layers here that I can remove, add in an instant. Everything is written in SVG and Angular. OK? Let's add some elements. You can do selection, which is represented both in the left side and the right side. You can do the selection on the right side here. You can scroll it. You can select some elements like this. You can do something like, let's create something that is called amino acid, convert this group into amino acid, and it didn't work, OK? Yeah, I promised you some bugs. Let's try to do it again. Okay. Yeah, we can see it because of the resolution. It is not supposed to run on small screens, okay? It's not meant to tablets or mobiles. It's meant to biologists that do research. I can try to do something like send this to another tool in the internet called BLAST, which might help some biologists to find a cure for cancer or something else. And I can change the font size here and do other interesting things, okay? Let's rotate the whole plasmid, okay? So this is the viewer that I created, and something happened here? Yes. Okay, so this is the viewer that I created, and that viewer is going to be shipped in 1 month, so I have time to fix all the bugs that you've probably seen. The company here is going to ship it as part of our tools, because they give other tools as well, not only viewer for genes, but collaboration tools for biologists and etc. So let's summarize the session. First of all, I introduced SVG, a small introduction, okay? Then I talk about how SVG and Angular can cooperate together. It's very simple, it's just DOM. So what you are used to doing, do it. And at the end, I showed you some fancy biology modeling that I created using SVG and Angular, and hopefully, that after this session, you'll have some notion of implementing your own things. Don't do just graphs, okay? That's lame. Create some sophisticated graphics, and Angular and SVG can cooperate and help you to do that. Thank you.